the tale of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, last messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, English edition, written by Muhammad Vandestra and narrated by Maghfirah binti Adam.
Chapter 1. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in Makkah, Arabia on Monday, 12 Rabi al-Awwal or 2 August AD 570. His mother, Amina, was the daughter of Wahb ibn Abdumanaf of the Zahra family. His father, Abdullah, was the son of Abdul Muttalib. His genealogy has been traced to the noble house of Ishmael, the son of Prophet Abraham, in about the 14th decennial. Muhammad's father died before his birth. Before he was 6 years old, his mother died, and the doubly orphaned Muhammad was put under the charge of his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, who took the most tender care of him. But the old chief died 2 years afterwards. On his deathbed, he confided to his son, Abu Talib, the charge of the little orphan. When Muhammad was 12 years old, he accompanied his uncle, Abu Talib, on a mercantile journey to Syria, and they proceeded as far as Busra. The journey lasted for some months. It was at Busra that the Christian Hmong Bahirah met Muhammad. He is related to have said to Abu Talib, "Return with this boy and guard him against the hatred of the Jews, for a great career awaits your nephew." After this journey, the youth of Muhammad seems to have been passed uneventfully, but all authorities agree in ascribing to him such correctness of manner and purity of morals as were rare among the people of Mecca. The fair character and the honorable bearing of the unobtrusive youth won the approbation of the citizens of Mecca, and by common consent he received the title of Al-Amin, the Faithful. In his early years, Muhammad was not free from the cares of life. He had to watch the flocks of his uncle, who, like the rest of the Bani Hashim, had lost the greater part of his wealth. From youth to manhood, he led an almost solitary life. The lawlessness rife among the Meccans, the sudden outburst of causeless and bloody quarrels among the tribes frequenting the fair of Okat, the Arabian Olympia, and the immorality and skepticism of the Quraysh naturally caused feelings of pity and sorrow in the heart of the sensitive youth. Such scenes of social misery and religious degradation were characteristic of a depraved age. When Muhammad was 25 years old, he traveled once more to Syria as a factor of a noble and rich Quraysh widow named Khadija, and having proved himself faithful in this commercial interest of that lady, he was soon rewarded with her hand in marriage. This marriage proved fortunate and singularly happy. Khadija was much the senior of her husband, but in spite of the disparity of age between them, the most tender devotion on both sides existed. This marriage gave him the loving heart of a woman who was ever ready to console him in his despair and to keep alive within him the feeble, flickering flame of hope when no man believed in him and the world appeared gloomy in his eyes. Until he reached 30 years of age, Muhammad was almost a stranger to the outside world. Since the death of his grandfather, authority in Mecca was divided among the 10 senators who constituted the governing body of the Arabian Commonwealth. There was no such accord among them as to ensure the safety of individual rights and property, though family relations afforded some degree of protection to citizens, yet strangers were frequently exposed to persecutions and oppressions. In many cases they were robbed, not only for their goods, but even of their wives and daughters. At the instigation of the faithful Muhammad, an old league called the Federation of Fudul. Favors was revived with the object of repressing lawlessness and defending every weak individual, whether Meccan or stranger, free or slave, against any wrong or oppression to which he might be the victim within the territories of Mecca. When Muhammad reached 35 years, he settled by his judgment a grave dispute, which threatened to plunge the whole of Arabia into a fresh series of her oft-recurring wars. In rebuilding the sacred house of the Kaaba in AD 605, the question arose as to who should have the honor of raising the black stone, the most holy relic of that house, into its proper place. Each tribe claimed that honor. The senior citizen advised the disputants to accept for their arbitrator the first man to enter from a certain gate. The proposal was agreed upon, and the first man who entered the gate was Muhammad al-Amin. His advice satisfied all the contending parties. He ordered the stone to be placed on a piece of cloth, and each tribe to share the honor of lifting it up by taking hold of a part of the cloth. The stone was thus deposited in its place, and the rebuilding of the house was completed without further interruption. It is related that, about this time, a certain Usman ibn Huayrith, supported by Byzantine gold, made an attempt to convert the territory of Hijaz into a Roman dependency, but the attempt failed, chiefly through the instrumentality of Muhammad. These are nearly all the public acts related by historians in which Muhammad took part in the first 15 years of his marriage to Khadija. As for his private life, he is described to have been ever helpful to the needy and the helpless. His uncle Abu Talib had fallen into distress through his endeavors to maintain the old position of his family. Muhammad, being rather rich at this time by his alliance with Khadija, tried to discharge part of the debt of gratitude and obligation which he owed to his uncle by undertaking the bringing up and education of his son Ali. A year later, he adopted Akil, another of his uncle's sons. Khadija bore Muhammad 3 sons and 4 daughters. All the males died in childhood, but in loving Ali, he found much consolation. About this time, Muhammad set a good example of kindness, which created a salutary effect upon his people. His wife Khadija had made him a present of a young slave named Zaid ibn Haritha, who had been brought as a captive to Mecca and sold to Khadija. When Haritha heard that Muhammad possessed Zaid, he came to Mecca and offered a large sum for his ransom, whereupon Muhammad said, "Let Zaid come here, and if he chooses to go with you, take him without ransom. But if it be his choice to stay with me, why should I not keep him?" Zaid, being brought into Muhammad's presence, declared that he would stay with his master, who treated him as if he was his only son. Muhammad no sooner heard this than he took Zaid by the hand and led him to the black stone of Kaaba, where he publicly adopted him as his son, to which the father acquiesced and returned home well satisfied. Henceforward, Zaid was called the son of Muhammad. Muhammad was now approaching his 14th year, and his mind was ever engaged in profound contemplation and reflection. Before him lay his country, bleeding and torn by fratricidal wars and intolerable dissensions, his people sunk in barbarism, addicted to the observation of rites and superstitions, were, with all their desert virtues, lawless and cruel. His 2 visits to Syria had opened to him a scene of unutterable moral and social desolation, rival creeds and sects tearing each other to pieces, carrying their hatred to the valleys and deserts of Hijaz, and rending the townships of Arabia with their quarrels and bitterness. Chapter 2. For years after his marriage, Muhammad had been accustomed to secluding himself in a cave in Mount Hira, a few miles from Mecca. To this cave he used to go for prayer and meditation, sometimes alone and sometimes with his family. There, he often spent the whole nights in deep thought and profound communication with the unseen yet all-knowing Allah of the universe. It was during one of those retirements and in the still hours of the night when no human sympathy was near that an angel came to him to tell him that he was the messenger.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.